टुडे माय टॉपिक इज लिम्फेडेक्टमी इन ओवेरियन कैंसर। माय सेल्फ डॉक्टर किशन सोनी, एमसीएच फर्स्ट ईयर स्टूडेंट, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ सर्जिकल ऑन्कोलॉजी, एमएसबीएचयू। एंड दिस प्रेजेंटेशन इज मेड अंडर गाइडेंस ऑफ डॉक्टर तरुण कुमार बत्रा सर, प्रोफेसर एचओडी, डिपार्टमेंट सर्जिकल ऑन्कोलॉजी, एमएसबीएचयू। नाउ द बैकग्राउंड ऑफ दिस स्टडी, द रोल ऑफ लिम्फेडेक्टमी इन द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ ओवेरियन कैंसर हैज बीन एट द सेंटर ऑफ अटेंशन ड्यूरिंग द रिसेंट ईयर। द लिम्फेटिक स्प्रेड ऑफ द ओवरी डिस्क्राइब्ड बाय प्लेंटल एंड फ्रीडमैन एट अल that the lymphatic vessel of the ovary converges upon the hilus of the ovary to form subovarian lymphatic plexus. From there there is a three routes. The main routes along the bilateral ovarian blood vessels to common iliac and aortic nodes, and less frequently along the round ligament, that is external iliac and inguinal lymph node. The lymph node metastasis in ovarian cancer according to the stage. The stage 1, the involvement of parietal lymph node is 18% and the pelvic is 9%, same in stage 2, that is 20% and 10% respectively, stage 3, that is 41.9 and 12.9 respectively, and stage 4, 66.7 and 33.3% respectively. There are studies that Bugard et al. 1991, Carino et al., Beochi et al., they showed that nodal metastases have been shown to be independently correlate with survival in epithelial ovarian cancer, both in advanced and early stage malignancy. These are the various studies which shows the involvement of pelvic, aortic or bath lymph node in percentage. The average of all these studies is that the involvement of pelvic only lymph node in ovarian malignancy is 18.3%, the involvement of aortic lymph nodes only is 13.1%, and involvement of both of the pelvic and aortic lymph node is 17.3%. Factor influencing the lymphatic spread, that is site. According to site, if disease confined to the ovary, the chances of lymph node metastasis is 10 to 15%. If disease spreads to the abdomen, it is the chances of lymph node metastasis 64 to 67%. And if the one ovary is involved, the chances of ipsilateral pelvic lymph node involvement is 7%, ipsilateral aortic lymph node involvement is 7%, and both is 4%. Then grade of tumor is described by Benedetti Pensi et al. In 2005. That is grade 1, the chances of lymph node metastasis is 9%, and grade 2, 7%, and grade 2, 32%. Also, histologic type. Undifferentiated and anaplastic tumor have higher chance of lymphatic metastasis, and the mucinous is the less chance of the lymph node metastasis. Also, the differentiation. That well-differentiated and moderately differentiated tumor, the chances of lymph node metastasis is 10%, and poorly differentiated tumor, the chances of metastasis is 20%. Indication of lymphadenectomy is still debate for both early and advanced disease. In early stage, the chances of lymph node metastasis is less, so lymphadenectomy should be limited to those patients having greater risk of nodal spread. And in advanced stage, the chances of lymph node involvement is high. Also, the poor prognosis of patients with lymphatic metastasis and frequent finding of positive node at second look. Due to this reason, the lymphadenectomy may have a role in the cytoreduction of this patient. Surgery, mostly done in pelvic lymph node dissection. The boundaries of pelvic lymph node dissections are proximally its bifurcation of each common iliac artery, distally that circumflex iliac vein, medially internal iliac artery, laterally genital femoral nerve, and inferiorly obturator nerve. Similarly, in retroperitoneal lymph node dissection, the standard bilateral inferior nerve is pairing RPLND. The extent of this lymph node dissection is proximally the level of renal hilum, distally the common iliac bifurcation, and laterally both sides from that is the ureter, right and left ureter. Now, lymphadenectomy in epithelial ovarian cancer. This is the study, the stage and histologic subtype dependent frequency of lymph node metastasis in patient with epithelial ovarian cancer undergoing systematic pelvic and parietal lymphadenectomy, published in 2018 in Society of Surgical Oncology. The aim of this study is to evaluate whether the frequency of lymph node metastasis in patient with different tumor stage and histologic subtype undergoing systematic pelvic and parietal lymphadenectomy is coincidentally divergent. The study period was January 2000 to December 2016, and the total number of patients is 762. Is a prospective type of study. The result of this study is that median number of lymph node removed, the median number of removed lymph node is 69, each 69 patient, 69 lymph node. The metastasis of lymph node was found in 54.7% of the patient, and serous variety has the lymph node metastasis in serous, mucinous and clear cell variety is 20%, 0%, and 3.6% respectively. Also, the lymph node metastasis in dependency on stage and histological subtype. As the stage is increased, the chances of involvement of mean number of lymph node is increased, that is 0.9 to 13.5. And also the histologic type, the highest chance of lymph node involvement is high grade serous, and the lowest is low grade endometrial and the mucinous variety. The conclusion of this study is that lymph node metastasis in patient with epithelial ovarian cancer is dependent on stage and the histological subtype. Early mucinous or low grade endometrial EOC are at very low risk for retroperitoneal lymph node metastasis. Another study, that is systematic lymphadenectomy in the treatment of epithelial ovarian cancer, a meta-analysis of multiple epidemiological study. The objective of this study is to evaluate the role of systematic lymphadenectomy in epithelial ovarian cancer by comparing 5-year overall survival rate between systematic and unsystematic lymphadenectomy. The study period, the study included in this meta-analysis up to 2014, the total number of studies is 14, out of which 3 are RCTs and 11 are observational. The total number of patients included is 3,488. And the result of this study is that 5-year overall survival is higher in systematic lymphadenectomy group, advanced stage malignancy, and observational study. And there is no significant difference in randomized control trial, early stage disease, as patient with a residual tumor less than 2 cm. Conclusion of this study is that lymphadenectomy can improve the 5-year overall survival rate in advanced stage, but not in early stage or in patient with residual tumor less than 2 cm. These are the study which is included in this meta-analysis. Another study, the effect of lymphadenectomy on survival and recurrence in patient with ovarian cancer, a systematic review and meta-analysis, which is published in Japanese Journal of Clinical Oncology on 2016. The objective of the study is to assess the effectiveness of lymphadenectomy in patient with ovarian cancer. It's a meta-analysis. And a study up to 2015 include the number of studies 14. Out of 14, 3 are randomized controlled trial and 11 was retrospective. The result of these studies, that 5-year overall survival, total 13 studies were included, 3 RCT and 10 retrospective. All studies there showed that 5-year overall survival of the lymphadenectomy group was significantly greater. And the lymphadenectomy was associated with greater 5-year overall survival in patients with early and late stage ovarian cancer both. Then progression free survival. Total six studies were included, 2 RCT and 4 retrospective study. 2 RCTs said that lymphadenectomy was associated with great PFS, and 4 retrospective studies said no significant difference in PFS. In lymphadenectomy group, the greater PFS, lymphadenectomy was associated with greater PFS in patient with advanced ovarian cancer, but not in early stage ovarian cancer. Recurrence rate. For this, total 7 studies were included, 2 RCTs and 5 retrospective, and all studies were showed recurrence rate was significantly lower in lymphadenectomy group. Conclusion of this study is that lymphadenectomy provided survival benefit in patient with both early and late stage ovarian cancer. And effect of lymphadenectomy on progression-free survival and recurrence rate was only found in a patient with advanced stage disease, and in early stage disease, it was less clear. More RCT are needed to explore this issue. Now, early epithelial ovarian cancer. These are the studies which shows the involvement of pelvic, aortic, or both lymph nodes in early stage of epithelial ovarian cancer, in which the involvement of pelvic only lymph node is 5%, the involvement of aortic lymph node is 9%, and involvement of both of the pelvic and aortic lymph node is 6%. In early ovarian cancer patient, mainly the early ovarian cancer patient are oftenly surgically under-staged. The 2 staging steps that are most frequently omitted was retroperitoneal lymph node dissection and taking up blind biopsies. The incidence of lymph node involvement in apparently early ovarian cancer in stage 1 is 14% and stage 2 is 38%. I study that lymph node sampling and taking of blind biopsies are important element of surgical staging of early ovarian cancer by Petra et al., published in June 2010 by Gynecological Cancer, Journal of Gynecological Cancer. The aim of the study is to determine the effect of lymph node sampling and taking of blind biopsies as a part of surgical staging procedure for early ovarian cancer who received no adjuvant chemotherapy. It's a randomized controlled trial, include 448 patients. The study period was November 1990 to March 2000 only, and there are groups and subgroups. These are divided in 2 groups, that only surgery include two to four patients, but surgery and adjuvant chemotherapy that 224 patients. Now subgroup is group A, B, C that involve 75, 46 and 14 patients. The group A is optimally staged patient. That means TH, BSO, omentectomy and lymphadenectomy. Group B, all staging step except lymph node sampling, and group C, that is all staging step except no blind peritoneal biopsy. The result of this study is that 5-year oral survival was 89% in group 1, 71% in group B and 65% in group C. Similarly, in disease-free survival, that is 79%, 61% and 64% respectively, and the chances of recurrence is 14.6%, 34.8% and 35.7% respectively. In intraperitoneal disease progression is also increased in group C patient and less in group A patient. The conclusion of this study is both the 5-year disease-free survival and 5-year oral survival were statistically significant for optimally staged patient. Another randomized study of systematic lymphadenectomy in patient with epithelial ovarian cancer macroscopically confined to the pelvis. The objectives of this study is to assess the impact of systematic lymphadenectomy on progression-free survival and overall survival, and the assessment of complications related to systematic lymphadenectomy. The study period is January 1991 to May 2003. The type of this is a randomized control trial. Total number of patients is 268, in which out of this 268, 138 patients underwent for systematic lymphadenectomy and 130 patients for sampling. The result of this study is that 5-year overall survival is 84% in systematic lymphadenectomy group and 81.6% in sampling group. Progression-free survival is 78.3% and 73.4% respectively, and the mean median of operation time, median blood loss, positive lymph node and recurrence, they are all more in median operating time, median blood loss are more in systematic lymphadenectomy group, and the recurrence is more in sampling group. The conclusion of this study is the systematic lymphadenectomy was associated with an improvement in progression-free survival and oral survival, but it is not statistically significant. Also, the systematic lymphadenectomy detects a higher proportion of patients with metastatic lymph node. Nearly a fourth of patients with early stage ovarian cancer turn to have retroperitoneal lymphatic spread, and its stage is increased. The recurrence, that is 22% is systematic lymphadenectomy group. The 22% of women who were presumed to have early stage ovarian cancer are upstaged during the lymphadenectomy procedure. Now, advanced epithelial ovarian cancers. These are the studies which include the involvement of pelvic and aortic lymph node in percentage. The average of this study in advanced epithelial ovarian cancer, that involvement of pelvic lymph node is 13%, involvement of aortic lymph node is 17%, and involvement of both lymph node is 35%. This is the study that Benedetti Pensi et al. In 2005, it's a randomized control trial evaluating the role of lymphadenectomy in advanced stage disease, which undergo systematic lymphadenectomy in 216 patients and resection of bulky nodes only in 2011 patients. The result of this study shows that overall survival is 56.3 months in systematic lymphadenectomy group, and resection of bulky node is 58.7%, and progression free survival is 29.4 months in lymphadenectomy group and 22.4 months in resection of bulky nodes. No significant difference in OS, oral survival, but in patient lymphadenectomy group achieved 7 month longer median progression free survival. Another study, that is Chan et al. 2007 retrospective study, has a similar result. This study that impact of pelvic and periaortic lymphadenectomy in advanced ovarian cancer after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. The aim of study is to evaluate the impact of systematic pelvic and periaortic lymphadenectomy in patient with advanced ovarian cancer after neoadjuvant therapy. It's a multicenter descriptive study from January 1998 to December 2012. It includes the patient with initially inoperable advanced ovarian cancer, that is figure 3 and 4, undergoing neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by cytoreductive surgery with no residual tumor. It includes 101 patients. Out of this, 54 underwent to systematic lymphadenectomy and 47 has no lymphadenectomy. The result of this study, that median overall survival is 36.3 months in lymphadenectomy group and 33.1 months in no lymphadenectomy group. 5-year overall survival is 35% in lymphadenectomy group and 25.8% in no lymphadenectomy group, and median progression-free survival is 97.1 9.7 month and 10.4 month respectively. The overall survival and the progression-free survival show no significant difference between the two groups. Conclusion of this study is that systematic lymphadenectomy does not seem to improve the overall, not the progression-free survival rate. This result should be confirmed by further control studies. The study that a randomized trial of lymphadenectomy in a patient with advanced ovarian neoplasm. The objective of this, primary objective is overall survival, secondary is progression-free survival. Study period is December 2008 to January 2012. This study include a newly diagnosed advanced ovarian cancer, that is 2B to 4, who undergone macroscopically complete resection and had normal lymph node both before and during surgery. The total number of patients included in this study is 647. Lymphadenectomy done in 323 patients and no lymphadenectomy in 324 patients. The result of this study is this progression-free survival is same for both the group, and the median overall survival is more in no lymphadenectomy group and less in lymphadenectomy group, that is 16.5 month and 69.2 month. The 60-day mortality is more in lymphadenectomy group. The duration of surgery, blood loss, requirement of blood transfusion, ICU admission, post-operative, chances of lymphatic cyst development, and chances of repeat laparotomy, these all are more in lymphadenectomy group. In this study, the median number of removed lymph node is 57, that is 35 from pelvis and 22 from paraaortic lymph node. More complication was seen in lymphadenectomy group. Microscopic lymph node metastasis seen in 55.7% of patients. The conclusion of this study is that systematic pelvic and paraaortic lymphadenectomy was not associated with better outcome, but associated with a higher incidence of postoperative complications. Then study a survival outcome of ovarian cancer patient treated with secondary cytoreductive surgery for isolated lymph node recurrence. A systematic review of literature published in 2019 in Indian Journal of Surgery. The aim of the study is to investigate whether secondary cytoreduction benefit patient with isolated lymph node recurrence in terms of overall survival and post-relapse survival. It includes the studies till February 2019. The total number of included studies 10, in which case series is 3 and cohort is 7. The total number of patients is 436. These are the included study. The result of this study is the various studies shows that PRA Eugen et al. So that PR is 44 month, Sentinel 37 month, Blanchard 26 month, 44 month, and also 5-year survival in all the studies 71% in Eugen et al. Blanchard is 50%, in Foto et al. Is 68%, Ferro et al. Is 64%, and the median overall survival is 114 month in Eugen et al. Sentinel et al. Is 61 month, Blanchard 68 month, Foto et al. Is 66 month. The conclusion of this study is that patient with ILNR should be treated with combined surgical and chemotherapeutic approach to optimize survival outcomes, and further studies are needed to reach firm conclusion as a current evidence is based in low quality studies. The Gaducci et al. That similar studies that compared 44 patients with EOC that received chemotherapy to 22 patients that had secondary cytoreduction for isolated lymph node recurrence that was followed by chemotherapy concluded that women treated with secondary cytoreduction and chemotherapy had decreased order of disease-related death. Yet another study, that is therapeutic value of selective lymphadenectomy in interval debulking surgery for stage 3C and 4 epithelial ovarian cancer. Aim of the study is to evaluate the systematic and selective lymphadenectomy during interval debulking surgery in patient with radiologic evidence of lymph node metastasis at initial diagnosis that ultimately became negative on imaging after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. The type of study is retrospective, which the patient included from January 1996 to January 2016. The total number of patients is 330, out of which the selective lymph node dissection was done in 145 patients. The systematic lymph node dissection was done in 118 patients, and no lymphadenectomy was done in 67%. The result of this, the median progression-free survival, the median overall survival is more in systematic lymphadenectomy group, and the chances of lymphedema and lymph, lower limb lymphedema and lymph cyst formation is more in systematic lymphadenectomy group. No significant, but advantage of oral survival and progression-free survival is not statistically significant. Conclusion of this study is that extent of lymphadenectomy, that is whether selective or systematic, had no significant impact on progression-free survival or overall survival. But the risk of lower extremity lymphedema and lymphocyst formation were lower in patient who underwent selective lymphadenectomy. These are the related trials to this study, that is Loyne trial, Swag et al., EO et al., Pensi et al., and Fagotti et al. So the similar result, the similar results. A study that is prognostic significance of systematic lymphadenectomy in patient with optimally debulked advanced ovarian cancer, a meta-analysis published in February 2020 in Frontiers in Oncology. The aim of this study is to evaluate the therapeutic value of systematic lymphadenectomy in advanced ovarian cancer patient who underwent primary optimal debulking surgery. A study include till August 2019, the total number of studies 7, that is 2 RCT and 5 observational study, and the total number of patients is 2425. These are the studies which were included in this study. The result of this study, this all of the study provide overall survival data. And the pooled analysis indicate that systematic lymphadenectomy significantly improved overall survival. PFS was only, progression-free survival is only available in 4 of the studies and indicate no significant difference in PFS between the lymphadenectomy group and unlymphadenectomy group. Conclusion of the study is, in patients with optimally debulked advanced ovarian cancer, the systematic lymphadenectomy may improve OS but not progression-free survival. And systematic lymphadenectomy does not provide a survival advantage when macroscopically complete resection of all visible tumor is achieved. A study that is systematic lymphadenectomy in ovarian cancer at second look surgery, a randomized clinical trial, published in British Journal of Surgery in 2012. The aim of the study is to assess the systematic lymphadenectomy at second look surgery in early stage or optimally debulked advanced ovarian cancer, which include the patient with histologically proven epithelial cancer with FIGO stage 1A to 4 after primary surgery with or without adjuvant chemotherapy and with no evidence of disease on chest, abdomen and pelvis on CT scan. The study period is January 1991 to May 2001 and total number of patients included is 308. The result of this study is assessed in 3-year, 5-year and 10-year. So the progression survival, that is 3-year, 5-year and 10-year, is more in no lymphadenectomy group. Also, in overall survival, in 3-year, 5 and 10 year, is more in no lymphadenectomy group. The conclusion of this study is that the lymphadenectomy at second look surgery after first line chemotherapy in women with ovarian cancer offers no benefit. Or if a patient who have incomplete or inadequate endoperatorial primary cytoreductive surgery before, only nodal biopsies and removal of suspicious nodes should be performed, both in early stage and late advanced stage malignancy. Now, mucinous ovarian carcinoma. It's a rare malignancy. It's a rare epithelial ovarian carcinoma. This study is lymphadenectomy necessary in mucinous ovarian cancer, a single student experience, published in International Journal of Surgery on 2017. A study include that the role of lymphadenectomy in initial management of primary early mucinous ovarian cancer remains unclear. Objective of this study is to describe the prevalence of pelvis and parotid node metastasis in MOC. It's a random retrospective study from June 2005 to December 2011, which include 31 patients. Out of 31, 14 underwent to lymphadenectomy and 17 was not included in lymphadenectomy. The result of this study is the median number of pelvic lymph node removed is 9 per patient and the aortic lymph node removed is 5 per patient, and there was no evidence of metastatic disease in the dissected lymph nodes. But the disease-free survival and overall survival in this study is more in lymphadenectomy group, but this benefit in the disease-free survival and overall survival is due to involvement of 92.86% of the patient in lymphadenectomy group is stage 1 and 2 who had already a good prognosis. Multiple authors have confirmed that mucinous tumor grossly limited to the ovary will not have an occult lymphoid metastasis. But a significantly different DFS was seen between the separate tumor grade. That is, if it is a grade 1, grade 2, grade 3 tumor, the chances of the 5-year disease-free survival is 86%, 82%, and 57%. The conclusion of this study is that this result suggests that complete surgical staging with lymph node dissection has no effect on recurrence, disease-free survival, and overall survival of patient with early stage mucinous ovarian carcinoma. It's a meta-analysis, that is surgical lymph node assessment in mucinous ovarian carcinoma staging, published in 2016 in International Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology. The objective of the study is to review the literature on surgical lymph node assessment during staging of women diagnosed with mucinous ovarian carcinoma. Number of studies 16. Out of 16, two were prospective and 14 were retrospective. And the number of patients is 2 to 4, 5 with mucinous histology, 623 patients. The study period is up to 21 May 2015. The result of this study is when the stage 1 or stage 2 disease is suspected during MOC staging, the addition of lymph node assessment will only identify metastasis in 0.8% patient. So abstaining from routine lymph node dissection would reduce, two to 3% risk of intraoperative complications such as vascular, nerve, ureteric, and bowel injury. Conclusion of the study is surgical lymph node assessment in women suspected of stage 1 to mucinous ovarian carcinoma rarely identifies nodal metastasis and consequently has no significant impact on staging. Based on the current literature, there is no evidence to support that survival is influenced by complete lymph node dissection or lymph node sampling. Now, germ cell tumor. The malignant germ cell tumor of the ovary are rare. It accounts for 7% of ovarian cancer, which is highly chemosensitive. The incidence of lymph node metastasis in malignant germ cell tumors are in this germinoma 28%, malignant teratoma 8%, and mixed germ cell tumor that is 16%. This is the study that prognostic impact of lymphadenectomy in clinically early stage malignant germ cell tumor of the ovary. The aim of which published in 2011 in British Journal of Cancer. The aim of the study is to determine the impact of lymphadenectomy and nodal metastasis on survival in clinical stage 1 malignant ovarian germ cell tumor. The study period is 1988 to 2006. Total number of patients is 1,083. Lymphadenectomy performed in 493 patients. It has three groups, that is LND1, LND+1, LND+3C. LND1, that is patient with disease grossly confined to ovary and no lymphadenectomy was done. Second group, that +1, this FIGO stage 1, include patient with disease grossly confined to ovary who underwent lymphadenectomy with histologically negative nodes. Then third is +3C group, that is FIGO stage 3C, patient with disease grossly confined to ovary who underwent lymphadenectomy with histologically positive nodes. The result of this study is that LND+1 group, 89.5% were not negative and 52% were not positive. In the 5-year survival, in three group is 96.9%, 97.7%, 93.4%. That is not statistically significant. The conclusion of the study is that this study found the addition of lymphadenectomy did not provide survival benefit in patient whose disease was clinically confined to ovary. Sex cord stromal tumors. This is the study that pattern of metastasis in sex cord stromal tumor of the ovary can routine staging lymphadenectomy be omitted is published 2009. The ovarian sex cord stromal tumor are rare, accounting for only 7% of ovarian malignancy. The objective of this study is to determine the risk of lymph node metastasis in patient with SCSTs. The study type is retrospectively involved. The study period is 1985 to July 2005. 2,257 patients include. Out of these, complete or incomplete staging procedure were done in 111 patients. Complete staging in 72 patients, that is lymph node removal 47 patients. And incomplete staging 39 patients, out of which the lymph node removal is 11 patients. Result shows that none had positive lymph node. No lymph node is positive. And the conclusion of the study that lymph node involvement in sex cord stromal tumor of the ovary is extremely rare. Routine pelvic and parotid lymphadenectomy can be safely omitted from the surgical staging procedure for this specific group of ovarian neoplasm. Now, sentinel lymph node mapping. The rate of lymph node involvement in early epithelial ovarian cancer is relatively low, ranging from 6% to 30%. And pelvic and periotic lymphadenectomy is routinely performed in early ovarian cancer to define the stage of disease. Venuelli et al. Reported the first description of sentinel lymph node identification in the ovary in 1991. In order to reduce the associated morbidity of lymphadenectomy, sentinel node mapping has evolved, and the standardization of this procedure is needed before it can be tested in large multicenter studies. This is the study that feasibility of sentinel lymph node mapping of the ovary, systematic review published in July 2009 in International Journal of Gynecological Cancer. The study period is June 1991 to February 2019. Number of study included is 10 and total number of patients is 145. Laparotomy done in 113 patients, that is 78% of patients, and minimally invasive surgery done in 22% of patients. Site of injection. The total 4 injections were given on the dorsal and ventral side of the proper ovarian ligament and the infundibulopelvic ligament close to the ovary just underneath the peritoneum. The most common site in this study is ovarian ligament, ovarian infundibular ligament, then mesovarium, then hilum of ovary, then ovarian cortex. But to study, an injection into ovarian cortex appeared to be less sensitive. The most common agent used in this is technetium 99, that is 75.2%, and the median time of detection was 15 minutes. The detection rate. The overall detection rate was 90.3%. When we use radiocolloid, it is 88.1%. When the radiocolloid is combined with endocyanin green, the detection rate was 100%. And only endocyanin green alone was used, then the detection rate was 93.3%. The mean detection rate in pelvic lymph node was 44%, and the mean detection in aortic lymph node was 82%. And location of sentinel lymph node. That 65.7% the lymph node is found in periotic region, and 12.4% is pelvic only, and both 21.9%. Also, the site of sentinel lymph node. Total 67 patients included assessed that ipsilateral site, the ipsilateral side is 94%, bilateral is 3%. Limitation of this study is differed in exact location of lymph node, number of injection, tracer used, and time interval. But conclusion of the study is, this study proposed the standardized technique of one injection in both suspensory and the infundibular pelvic ligament of the ovary in all patients with high suspicion of an ovarian mass limited to the ovary. Number of studies identified in the overall sample size of patient included are too small to draw definite conclusion. Complication of lymphadenectomy. That is a study that evaluation of intraoperative and postoperative complication related to lymphadenectomy in ovarian cancer patient published in 2011. It's a retrospective study involved 469 patients. It has two groups, that lymphadenectomy group and no lymphadenectomy group, which involve lymphadenectomy group involved 211 patients and no lymphadenectomy group involved 258 patients. The intraoperative complication like hemorrhage, urine system damage, digestive tract, and other complications are more in lymphadenectomy group. Similar in postoperative complication, all complications, that is abdominal hemorrhage, intestinal junction tension, fistula, urinary tract fistula, eventration, anemia, wound healing complication, wound infection, missing data. This is all more in lymphadenectomy group, except postoperative fever, that is more in no lymphadenectomy group. The conclusion of this study is that intraoperative and postoperative complication were reported to be high in lymphadenectomy group, and postoperative complication were statistically significant. Magioni et al. In 2006, P. Harter et al. 2019, and Ensong et al. 2019, they have similar results. Now summary. All study which we were studied before are summarized in this table. This table, and most of the studies show there is no significant benefit of overall survival and progression-free survival in lymphadenectomy group. The role of lymphadenectomy in ovarian cancer has always been a topic of debate in past few decades. Numerous studies have been carried out in this respect. However, RCT and meta-analysis of these studies are not found to be conclusive enough. It can be concluded that lymphadenectomy is beneficial in advanced stage epithelial ovarian cancer, but not in early stage epithelial ovarian cancer or in patient with residual tumor less than 2 cm. But the fact that every fourth patient with early stage ovarian cancer turns out to have retroperitoneal lymphatic spread and that 9% to 25% of patient in early stage ovarian cancer are found to have positive nodes should also be considered. In case of early malignancy, even though the systematic lymphadenectomy was seen to be associated with an improvement in progression-free survival and overall survival in meta-analysis, it was not statistically significant. In case of advanced EOC, maximum number of studies support the fact that the lymphadenectomy does not seem to improve the overall nor the progression-free survival rate. However, there are few studies that Penasi et al., Wang et al., we saw that lymphadenectomy has effect on recurrence, increased overall survival, and median progression-free survival. Similar in case of mucinous cancer or germ cell ovarian tumor, there is no evidence to support the complete lymph node dissection or lymph node sampling has any effect on recurrence, disease-free period, and overall survival of patient. In case of sex cord stromal tumor, the lymphadenectomy could be safely omitted from the surgical staging procedure since positive nodes are extremely rare in this case. Post-operative morbidity has been reported to be significantly higher in patients who underwent a lymphadenectomy, and complications were lower in patients who underwent selective lymphadenectomy or no lymphadenectomy. In recent years, the sentinel lymph node mapping has emerged as promising alternative for lymphadenectomy. Sentinel lymph node mapping using endosenin grease found to have a maximum detection rate. However, it is not validated since it was done only in a few number of cases. Whatever evidence that has been used in this compilation is based on low quality studies with minimal number of sample, based on which we cannot arrive at any convincing conclusion. Therefore, further studies are needed in this part of oncology to reach firm conclusion.
One of the questions which has come up is, what is the role of lymphadenectomy in borderline tumors in ovarian cancers? Do you want to say anything on that?
Kishan, you have not answered.
Sorry, I didn't read that part, sir.
Yeah. Borderline. Basically, from the surgical point of view, when you are going for surgery, you actually do not know whether you are dealing with a borderline or not borderline tumor. Borderline tumor is something that you know after the surgery, the resection has been done. So when you are going in for a surgery, normally we do not perform a biopsy in ovary. So when you are going in, at that particular time, you have to deal with borderline tumors just like you are dealing with a normal ovarian carcinoma. So there is no separate guidelines for borderline tumor as far as lymphadenectomy is concerned. But most of the studies have shown that the spread to the retroperitoneum from borderline is very, very low.
Sir, how many, sir, minimum lymph node to be harvested? Pelvic and the low lymph node.
Ajay, do you think any lymph node need to be harvested? With the data he has presented, can you summarize what he has presented?
Sir, in the many study, he has presented the number of lymph node also.
Okay.
So many.
So what is the conclusion of the presentation? Last three slides.
Sir, conclusion is that, sir, the number of lymph node harvesting does not carry the any overall survival.
Ajay, he has not talked about lymph node. He has talked number of lymph node. He has talked about something else. He has drawn a conclusion that at present, whether to do a lymphadenectomy or do not do a lymphadenectomy is not clear, because the survival and the progression-free survival between both the groups is equal. So when you are debating a question whether to do a lymphadenectomy or do not do a lymphadenectomy, where is the optimal number of lymph nodes? The question of optimal number of lymph nodes will come only when you have established that a lymphadenectomy is definitely required. Nobody has studied what is the optimal number. But the number that people have taken out is from 9 to 50, 55, 56, median number of lymph nodes.
Sir, one more question is there.
Yes.
Sir, in case of retroperitoneal lymph node, sir, the retroperitoneal lymph node boundary is same for we are dealing the testicular tumor or in the there is a different boundary.
See, nobody uses a template dissection in ovary. Nobody is doing it. It is not recommended, a template dissection. most of the people are using lymph node sampling. Yeah, na? So you go in, you see if the lymph nodes are bulky, you take them out. You do a lymph node sampling in most of the time because you have not yet established that doing a systematic lymphadenectomy actually makes a difference. But yes, when you have to do it, it is going to be almost same as that of testis. Now I'll ask you, Ajay, why these studies have failed to show any benefit of lymphadenectomy, even in advanced cancers, whether it is epithelial, germ cell, why there is no benefit? Or what is the fallacies of these studies? What is the reason that these studies have failed to show any benefit? And I'm sure further studies will also show no benefit.
Sir, because the lymphatic drainage of the ovary is not concentrated. It is divided into three parts. So the tumor, all the tumor cells will be not going to the...
You are not thinking in the right direction, Ajay. Ovarian malignancies are highly chemosensitive. And in all these studies, the adjuvant chemotherapy would have been used or the new adjuvant chemotherapy would have been used. So in all the malignancies where systemic therapy is very effective, lymph node metastasis is not going to alter the prognosis of the patient. You understand?
Yes, sir.
Be it breast, there is no difference. Local recurrence and the lymph node does not alter the prognosis. Even in head and neck, if there is a local recurrence, it does not alter the overall survival. It does changes the progression-free survival because recurrence occurs. But it does not alter the overall survival. So in most of the places where there is an adjuvant therapy given, the lymph node harvest does not actually make a difference on the overall survival. So this is called confounder. So confounder in all the studies of ovarian cancer is adjuvant therapy. Even if you are talking of the trials of debulking trials after the recurrence in the periaortic lymph nodes, there also adjuvant chemotherapy is a confounder. Because even if you do a periaortic lymph node clearance, you are still going to use the chemotherapy. And the moment you use chemotherapy, whether you do the lymphadenectomy or you don't do the lymphadenectomy, it doesn't make a difference because it's a chemosensitive tumor. It's a platinum sensitive or taxane sensitive tumor. So the problem is going to be this. If you look at the those patients who are platinum or taxane refractory, there the lymphadenectomy will actually going to make a difference because you don't have an effective treatment. Subramaneshwar sir, you want to contribute? Dr. Patnaik is also there, I think. Dr. Manisha?
Hello, everybody.
Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yeah, very much. Loud and clear.
I came in a little bit late, so I just got to hear about the last half an hour of the discussion. But I was a little surprised about the conclusion and everything which was being discussed. Because see, what I don't do a lot of ovary, but what I remember and what I do is in stages, except for stage 4, lymph node dissection is an integral part of staging and therapeutic value. And there are studies, I believe there are a lot of studies which say that in stage 2 and 3 especially, the number of nodes harvested would actually have some kind of prognostic benefit. And what is recommended is somewhere around 16 to 30 nodes total, pelvic and periaortic bilateral. That is what is recommended. So I was a little surprised about the conclusion and I couldn't see any reference to those studies which say that it has got a prognostic value. So what do I do about this?
Basically, the change in scenario has come after the 2019 NEJM randomized controlled trial has been published. This is one of the largest clinical trial which compared no lymphadenectomy versus systematic lymphadenectomy and showed no difference in PFS and OS and a huge increase in the complication rates. So this study, there are only two RCTs in I think two RCTs that has looked at well-designed RCTs, which has looked at this question. And except for one, these two RCTs, both of them have shown no point. And I think there has been two other older RCTs, out of which only Petra's RCT has shown a benefit. All other studies which has been done, the randomized control trials and the prospective trials, have failed to show any benefit. That is what has changed. And from 2019, when NEJM article published, the debate has actually become stronger, and people are looking for solid evidence now.
Yeah, I assume that there would not be a lot of randomized trials, but there would be case series, and those published in 2012, 15. I often remember one or two case series which actually showed that there is a benefit of the more lymph node you harvest, the better will be the survival. Yes, you are right that the complication rate also increases, but I didn't find any reference to those.
No, studies. He has presented a lot of studies which has shown benefit. The most of the retrospective, if you look at most of the retrospective studies, they have shown benefit. They have shown benefit. But the problem with retrospective studies is that they are biased. So you don't know that the patient who are included in the lymphadenectomy template are the patient who had had lymph node present on CT or MRI or not. So it's quite possible that they might be doing lymphadenectomy only in select cases and not doing it in others.
So the selection bias
that comes to play when you are dealing with retrospective studies. Those selection biases are not there when you are dealing with a randomized control trial.
Yes.
And that is why the randomized control trial data is more robust. And even the 2019 meta-analysis that also include 2019 meta-analysis, no, Sony? Or 2020? The last meta-analysis was in 19. That also included the NEJM publication, and okay. that meta-analysis has shown that there is no benefit. So most of the studies so far have shown that there is no benefit.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So there is a question from Bharat: role of frozen section in deciding extent of lymph node dissection intraoperatively. Whether to decide parotid lymph node based on pelvic node status. Bharat, I'll just again say that because we don't know that if there is a benefit of lymphadenectomy or not, at the time being, the staging is more or less based on the sampling rather than the full clearances of the lymph node. So as and when the more evidence comes, we will be able to say whether the frozen section is helping or frozen section is not helping. Anshika is asking, what is the false negative rate for sentinel lymph node in biopsy? Okay, Anshika, I don't know. But the false negative rate in sentinel lymph node probably will depend upon the false negative rate of the frozen section. So I'll assume that it should be same as elsewhere. Because the only limiting step in a sentinel lymph node biopsy is the frozen section. I'm actually not aware.
Dr. Pandey, there is one question I wanted.
Yeah, please.
This is something I'm curious about. It's probably not very much in context with the discussion that is going on. See, if you have a frozen section, how often do you, and you are going in without a biopsy on a patient who has got a imaging evidence, a suspicious imaging for a malignancy,
epithelial
ovarian cancer. Yes. What would be your staging be like? Like you would only do a TH, BSO and some lymph node sampling and a omental biopsy or what? What will be your staging protocol like? You do not know. You don't know
whether
you are dealing with a EOC or not.
True.
You do a TH, BSO. You might not have a frozen section. Would you depend on a frozen section? What?
I don't think anybody depends on a frozen section.
Yeah, exactly.
Make a diagnosis.
It's probably not very fair to the pathologist to give him a 20 centimeter tumor and say whether it's malignant or not.
So basically, everybody goes and does a TEH, BSO, lymph node sampling, omentectomy, and the peritoneal biopsies from the pelvis, both gutters, and subdiaphragmatic.
So you would not advise a lymph node clearance. You would rather advise sampling.
Sampling, because it's a staging laparotomy.
It's a staging laparotomy.
The purpose of surgery is a staging.
Yeah. So you complete your staging.
You complete your staging, and if you find a periotic lymph node, you upstage your disease to stage 3, and then patient goes for chemotherapy. Right, Tarun?
Is part of staging, because we used to do it. If you remember 15 years back,
we still do
include appendectomy for every stage. You still do. Okay,
appendectomy is if there is a JR scrubbed in,
you give it to him to do.
Yeah,
because that's all we used to get at some point of time to do. So you would advise appendectomy and a complete staging laparotomy, and you close the abdomen. Your histopathology comes that your lymph nodes are positive.
Yeah.
So would your adjuvant treatment include a
if it comes out that you are dealing with a stage 1A or 1B disease confined to ovary, there is no adjuvant. But if your lymph nodes or your peritoneal biopsies come positive, then you have to add adjuvant. You have to treat it like a stage 3 disease.
Yeah, you have to add adjuvant chemotherapy. What about surgery again? Would you like to go in and clear the lymph nodes?
Surgery will depend upon you do adjuvant, re-evaluate the patient and see if there is a residual disease. If you have a residual disease, then you go for interval cytoreduction. Otherwise, there is no need. If the patient is disease-free, CA125 is normal.
What I'm trying to ask is, if you have done a lymph node sampling and you end up with one of them positive, then would you advise going in and clearing the lymph nodes, or a adjuvant chemotherapy would suffice?
That's where we have presented that there is not enough evidence. So if you ask me, I will probably not go and clear it. I'll simply put the patient on chemotherapy.
Would go in and clear it.
I'll put the patient on chemotherapy and I'll do a PET scan after completion of chemotherapy. See if I have an uptake. If I have an uptake, I'll think of going in.
Think of an interval cytoreduction.
Interval cytoreduction. After the chemotherapy.
Fair enough.
After the chemotherapy. Because most of them would resolve with chemotherapy. Okay. There's a question. Is there a link between completeness of cytoreduction and lymphadenectomy? Tarun, you want to say? I think this is a very good question.
The same thing when you are answering that whether will you go in or no, because that will leave your, it is compromising your optimal cytoreduction.
Yes.
So I think, in case where the nodes are suspected, the nodes are enlarged, a full lymphadenectomy should be done. Irrespective of what the stage of the disease, if the nodes are enlarged,
yes. So basically, answer to this question is yes. There is a link between completeness of cytoreduction and lymphadenectomy. If you do not do a template lymphadenectomy, your cytoreduction may be incomplete. Maybe, or may not be. So you don't know until unless you do it. If you get all your lymph nodes negative, you will end up. There is a question from Neetu. What is the size of lymph node that is considered enlarged or bulky? I think any visible node. Or there is a standard size that you will say 1 centimeter I'll take out. Tarun, how do you decide which lymph node is going to be removed or should not be removed?
Intraoperatively, it's the same for almost all malignancies, where you find a round node, which is...
Yes.
Oblong nodes are more likely to be inflammatory or benign as compared to spherical, hard, enlarged nodes. That's what I'll decide on.
And is there a size like 1 centimeter or 2 centimeters?
One centimeter. Yes. Is
subcentric lymph nodes are usually not supposed to be. Anshika is very quiet today. Why?
Sir, I actually want to appreciate the presenter. He has put up the slides very well. For each and every slide, he has made a summary of every presentation. I want to appreciate that. And Thank you. Second point I have taken from the presentation is that, of course, lymph node dissection, we all agree with whatever he has concluded. But blind peritoneal biopsies have to be done for a staging, optimal staging.
Yes.
So that he has brought it out very clearly in his presentation. Yes.
Subbu sir has been very quiet. I don't know whether he is here or not, or only logged in and left. Any other comment? Any other questions that we have? Neetu is again asking, so we have to do a dissection to see the size of the lymph node. Neetu, we actually don't do the dissection. We open up the periotic space and the open the peritoneum and see if you find a node, you just take it out. We don't do a complete dissection in a sampling procedure. But you do have to open the peritoneum and you have to go to the retroperitoneum. You have to see by the sides of the vessel whether the lymph nodes are enlarged or not enlarged. Tarun, as there are no more questions, you summarize. And
To summarize, I would say that as of now, we don't have enough evidence to do a formal lymphadenectomy in early or advanced ovarian cancer, but as in when on radiology or intraoperatively, when you sample the node, and as in when you find enlarged node, which are suspicious to be involved, then a lymphadenectomy is advisable.
So you also advise a frozen section of lymph nodes you sample?
Sir, my decision will not depend on, if you have the facility, it should be done, agreed. But then there are a lot of fallacies of frozen section, especially in ovarian malignancies. So something which is negative intraoperatively may turn out to be positive on the final histopath. I would not rely much on the frozen section.
That was Anshika's question. So what is false negative rate?
I agree. As you said, sir, it's same as what... Her question was, what is the false negative rate of center biopsy? So that is the false rate of frozen section is the false negative rate of the frozen section.
But it's the same. Biopsy. But it's the same thing. No.
Same thing. It's the same thing.
When you are doing a lymph node sampling, you take out a node. You think it is probably involved. You send it for frozen section. It's the same thing as doing a sentinel node and sending it for the frozen section.
Sir, for the frozen section, false negative rate depends on how they gross the node. Yes. If they include both the cortex and the paracortex and the hilum, which way they cut the node, and also the sections, 2 mm, 4 mm, how many mm they cut it. So a lot of things go on actually with the frozen section. So if we have a dedicated team and they know everything about the patient, individual patient, probably going to improve the false negative
rate. In the best hands, you have almost 40% false negative rate. That is inherent of frozen sections. So the sensitivity, the specificity of frozen section is about 60% only. So 40% of the time, you may have false negative report. And that is why most of the time, you can't rely on frozen sections. But then most of the places where sentinel node has established, you will see that the frozen section is routinely being done and has shown a very good sensitivity. So say for example, breast, where sentinel lymph node is routinely being done. And the whole decision is based on the frozen section. So there had been frozen section much more sensitive. I think it depends upon how used to you are of doing a frozen section. And if you have a good pathologist, I think you should be able to very well make a diagnosis. Anything else, Tarun, you want to add?
No, sir.
So thank you, everybody, for participating. We'll meet again on Thursday.
Thank you.